Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Paradox Alley by John DeChancie. Narrated by Rudy, Sanda. 1. I don't know if God wears a beard. I've never had the pleasure of meeting him. Frankly, I hope to delay that happy occasion for as long as possible. The individual whose acquaintance I had just made didn't quite look the part, but I could have been persuaded otherwise right then. We had come a long way. All the way, it seemed, to the end of the universe. And here to greet us had been a surpassingly strange and beautiful creature possessed of a serenely transcendent, almost beatific aura. His foppish duds worked against the god image, though. I couldn't imagine the supreme being going around dressed like a galactic emperor out of some video space opera. And Carl, who stood beside me wearing a darkly subdued look, his fury temporarily spent, had seemed mighty sure of the identity of the person whose lights he had just punched out. I was fairly sure Carl didn't think the guy was the king of creation. Even so, we had a problem on our hands. Judging from his patrician bearing and sartorial finery, the person Carl had assaulted may have been very important. Extremely important. He, quite possibly, was in charge of this place, this world to which we had very recently been shanghaied. He had greeted us warmly, welcomed us. He'd invited us to lunch. What do? Quite without provocation, we smack the guy in the chops and knock him out. We were very possibly in deep trouble. Very possibly our ass was grass. I hoped our host didn't own a power mower. I looked down at the still form of the being, and he appeared for all the world to be a human being of the male persuasion who had called himself Prime. He was lying prone, face in the grass, the back of his head partly hidden beneath bunched folds of his expansive green cape. The rest of the garment spread out to his left over the ground. I glanced around. No lightning bolts, no clap of doom. I looked across the valley. No activity immediately apparent in the vicinity of the immense green crystalline fortress that surmounted the hill on the other side. Could Prime possibly be alone here? The notion struck me as absurd, but anything was possible on this strange artificial planet. Carl, I said, I can't take you anywhere.
It's him, he answered flatly. The voice that talked to me aboard the flying saucer. He's the one that nabbed me.
Can you be sure? After all, you never actually saw him. Did you? Carl frowned and stared at the ground, thought a moment, then turned to me.
No, but it has to be him. I'll never forget that voice.
Did the voice call itself Prime?
No. I don't remember it ever calling itself anything.
Then you really can't be sure, can you? Carl shrugged, then grudgingly acknowledged the point with a tilt of his head.
I guess. Maybe.
Then, quickly and with finality,
Nah, it's him.
That's hardly the issue, said John Sukuma Taylor behind us.
We turned. John stepped away from the rest of our companions, who were standing in a tight little knot. They were all shocked by what Carl had done, edgy and expectant. I probably looked the same way, but was trying to hide it. Lori still stood with her hands cupped over her mouth. Susan was aghast. She looked ill. Sean was shaking his head. The rest of them gazed silently at Prime. John, however, was angry.
Carl, that was an extremely stupid thing to do.
He stopped and threw up his arms in exasperation.
As if we hadn't enough problems. No, you have to hit him. How could you? Carl, how could you do something so...
He groped for the appropriate superlative.
So monumentally imbecilic. So...
He cast about for words, then brought up his hand and slapped his forehead.
Carl, you incredible idiot!
It was slowly dawning on Carl.
Yeah, I guess it was a dumb thing to do.
A dumb thing to do,
John repeated hollowly. He turned and appealed to the group.
A dumb thing to do,
he said again, nodding in mock approval. I had never seen John this ironic. He snapped his head around to fix Carl with a look of utter contempt.
You have a gift for understatement.
Unfortunately, it makes your stupidity all the more colossal.
Carl scowled.
Come off it. I just punched him. If he'd have done to you what he did to me...
That's hardly the point.
Did you stop to consider what the consequences might have been for us? The rest of us? Did you stop a single instant and think?
No. No, you...
Hold it, John, I said.
Jake, you can't possibly think he was justified.
No, it was dumb. But he's young. At his age, I might have done the same thing.
No excuse.
Probably not. But the whole question's kind of moot, isn't it? John's shoulders slumped.
Unfortunately, yes.
Liam detached himself from the group and walked toward us.
Isn't anybody going to see if he's all right?
I knelt beside Prime. Gingerly, I uncovered his head. I put my hand on his copper-colored hair. It was as soft and silky as a baby's. I moved his head to the right and looked at his face. The eyes were closed, the face serene. With my thumb, gently, very gently, I pried the left eyelid open. The iris was coal black with tiny flecks of purple. The pupil didn't respond to light, and the eye wasn't moving. I reached for his wrist. Rolling up the pleated cuff proved to be difficult, so I ran a middle finger under his jaw, tracing a line along the left neck muscle near the throat, trying to find the carotid artery. The skin was smooth, sleek, and dry. It was warm, but his body temperature was slightly lower than normal, or so I thought. But who knew what was normal for him? No carotid pulse. I looked at his left eye again, then swiveled his head to examine the right. Then I stood up.
He might be dead, I said.
Good God, John murmured. That's crazy,
Carl said in almost a whisper.
Oh my.
John came over to stand beside me.
Jake, are you quite sure?
No, but he doesn't have a heartbeat. Leastways, none I can detect. He's not breathing, I don't think. We should roll him over and...
Hell!
I slapped my forehead. The past several minutes had been so disorienting that I had slipped into a sort of semi-paralysis. Here, ostensibly, was a human being in need of help, and we were all standing around like dummies. I came out of it.
Darla, run and get the medikit. Know where it is?
Yes.
She ran back to the truck. I got out the key and called Sam.
This has all been very interesting, Sam observed.
Sam, set up to monitor this guy's life signs.
If he has any. Is he human?
Maybe. Maybe not.
Carl was slowly shaking his head in disbelief.
Crazy. I just poked him one. It couldn't have been enough.
It was enough, John said acidly.
Then he bent over slightly and peered at Prime's face.
Of all the bloody beastly luck.
He straightened and let out a long sigh.
Well, that's it, isn't it? We're all dead.
Not yet, I said. And he might not be either. My guess is he's not human. But human or not, Carl didn't hit him hard enough to kill him.
But if he's not human, how do you know what it would take to kill him?
You have a point.
I wish I didn't.
The others were edging forward now. Zoya and Yuri drew up closer and stopped.
I wonder who he is. Yuri said. What he is.
Darla came running with the medikit. I tore it open and took out 2 remote monitoring transponders.
Help me roll them over, John.
We were about to do so when Lori screamed.
I whirled.
Carl was lying on the ground. Sean evidently had caught him and was now cradling Carl's head in his arms.
What happened? John said.
Sean gently cuffed Carl's cheeks a few times.
Fainted did away, he did. Just keeled over.
I went over and crouched beside them, took Carl's wrist and felt for his pulse. It was slow and thin, dangerously so.
Is he okay? Susan asked.
Hard to tell, I said noncommittally. Funny that he'd pass out like that. Let me get a transponder for him.
Carl?
Lori took my place as I got up.
Carl? Oh no.
You'll be all right, girl.
Run and fetch some water. Lori ran off.
He's old cold, though, Sean said with concern. Dead old.
Jake, John said, indicating Prime.
What about...
If he doesn't have a pulse, there's not much I can do for him. And if he doesn't have a heart, all bets are off anyway. I'm more worried about Carl.
Well, finding out you've just killed somebody has to be a shock.
Maybe. Carl's not the type to faint dead away, though.
He's young. Just a boy, really.
Not that young. And I don't like the feel of his pulse.
I moved Lori aside and opened Carl's shirt. After removing the protective backing from the transponder, I stuck the disc-shaped device on his chest, positioning it over the left pectoral muscle. I prepared another and affixed it to the right pectoral, then went back and got 2 more transponders and put them on either side of his abdomen, just below the ribcage. I took the key out of my pocket.
Sam, are you getting any readings?
Yep. Pulse 44, with some irregularity in the atrial and ventricular rhythms. Got some inverted P waves, too, and the QRS complex looks kind of wacky.
What do you make of it?
Well, my medical program is telling me his heart is in trouble, and... Wait a minute. Yeah, it's getting worse.
What does the program say to do?
It's recommending things we can't do.
Is it an infarct or something?
Doesn't look like it. Actually, it's shaping up to look like congestive heart failure. Whoops. You're getting really bad irregularities now. If he goes into fibrillation, we can zap him, but that's not going to correct whatever the hell's wrong with him.
I felt my own heart frost over. He was dying.
Not possible, Sean said, shaking his head. A healthy lad like him.
Susan knelt beside me and squeezed my upper arm.
Jake, do something.
Sorry, was all I could say. Then, into the key.
Sam, congestive heart failure is a long-term process. How could it happen this fast?
Good question. The med program doesn't know, and neither do I.
But what the hell is it telling you?
Easy, son. It just keeps flagging things with anomalous event. It's pretty clear somebody's doing this to him, isn't it?
Very clear, John said. Obviously, this world deals in swift retribution.
Susan shot him a fierce look.
You don't have to say it with such satisfaction.
I have none, Susan, I assure you.
I said,
Sam, how is he?
Getting worse, I'm afraid. All kinds of arrhythmias, atrial flutter. It's a failing heart, Jake. Too many things going wrong at once. I really don't think we can do a thing for him, but you ought to try CPR in any case. I'd recommend starting it right now.
Right. Sean, stretch him out.
Righto.
Before we got to it, a voice came from behind us.
I'm really very sorry this happened.
Everyone whirled around before I got to my feet. Susan choked off a scream, and Liam uttered an odd,
Jesus Christ!
It was Prime, on his feet and looking fit and hale.
Very, very sorry, Prime was saying. I can't help but feel that it was in some way my fault.
His concern seemed
genuine, if inexplicable. "What are you doing to him?" I said.
"I beg your... Oh, I see. Yes. Well, I'm sure he'll be all right. Merely a precautionary measure."
"He's dying," I said.
Prime seemed surprised.
"Really? I can't think of a reason why he should be."
He stepped toward us, his eyes on Carl.
"Are you sure?"
"He'll be dead very shortly," I told him.
Prime stopped. His gaze began to drift upward, finally focusing, it seemed, on something far away.
I see. Yes.
He looked at me.
"The young man's life processes are being probed. Various components, various systems are being temporarily suppressed in order to obtain an overview of the entire organism. At least, that is what I am told."
"Unsuppress them," I said.
Prime smiled beatifically.
"You needn't worry. He's in very good hands. As it stands, the plan is to keep him sedated for the time being. However, that can be amended. And I see no reason why it shouldn't be. I'm sure the outburst was simply the result of the strains of your long journey."
I spoke into the key. "Sam, how's he doing?"
"Damnedest thing. The heart stabilized just like that. Pulse is up. No arrhythmia. Good sinus waves. Can't figure it. Those transponders must have been on the fritz."
"Carl's okay then?"
"He's coming around."
Prime was eyeing the truck.
"You have other companions inside?"
"No. That was the artificial intelligence who oversees the operation of my vehicle."
"I see."
He knitted his brow.
"Interesting way to put it."
I wondered what he meant.
Suddenly, the smile was back.
"We seem to have gotten off on the wrong foot. Again, our apologies. The invitation to lunch still stands, if you would do me the honor."
"Maybe we need to think about it for a bit," I said.
"As you wish. If you choose to come, simply follow the road across the valley. There is an entrance to my residence at the base of the mountain."
He turned and pointed.
"There, at the end of the road."
I couldn't see anything, but said thank you anyway.
"You're quite welcome."
Suddenly, Carl sat up. He looked around.
"Hello," he said.
Lori threw down the canteen she was holding, fell to her knees, and nearly strangled Carl in a hug. Susan bent over and placed a palm on his forehead.
"Are you okay, honey?"
"Oh."
Tugging at Lori's arms, Carl nodded. Prime clapped his hands.
"Well, no harm done."
"Let him breathe, Lori," Susan admonished.
"Yeah, I'm fine," Carl finally managed to say. "What the hell happened?"
"You should ask this gentleman," John told him, inclining his head toward Prime.
"Oh."
Carl looked up at our host.
"I thought you were dead."
Prime laughed.
"Not quite. Your friends seem prone to worrying about people's health, including yours."
Prime turned to me.
"By the way, your concern about me was very commendable. Thank you."
"You're welcome," I said. "You had me fooled pretty good, though. Tell me something. Are you human?"
"In part, yes."
After waiting for elaboration that didn't come, I repeated in part, not knowing what else to say. He was willing to go a bit further, but no more.
"A small part, but I assure you, a very active one."
He clapped his hands again.
"So, I shall bid you good day."
He made a motion to turn, then halted.
"Incidentally, young man..."
Carl was getting to his feet.
"Carl Chapin."
Prime took a step forward, his expression hardening just the slightest.
"Mr. Chapin, I have recommended that no restraints be put upon you and that you be allowed to move about as you wish. The concern here is not that you may cause me harm. You can't.
But an unruly attitude might get in the way of what we want to accomplish. Do I have your personal assurance that you will hereafter conduct yourself in a manner that is not disruptive?
Carl looked around uncomfortably.
Yeah, I guess.
He added quickly.
I mean, yeah, sure.
Prime's expression brightened again.
Very good. I shall look forward to seeing you, all of you, at my residence. Good day.
We watched him walk to his sleek black roadster, climb aboard, and close the clear bubble canopy. The engine whined to life. The vehicle wheeled around and swung onto the black surface of the skyway, the pitch of the engine increasing slightly. The thing whooshed down the road in the direction from which it had come, black, shiny wings starred with hot sun points. Just before reaching the bend, it rose from the roadway and soared into air. It climbed almost straight up, rising to about 300 meters before leveling off. It shot across the valley, a black triangle against the violet sky. It made a half turn around the fortress, then disappeared. John stared into the distance.
I wonder what he wants to accomplish.
2. We all piled into the truck and had a palaver.
Frankly, I don't see that we have a choice, John said after he had taken a swig from the canteen.
We had had to ration water the whole trip. 9 humans and 4 aliens had put a strain on the recycler. I was glad for checking the super extra spacious cabin option when I'd ordered the truck. Worth the extra money. Make a note.
Prime gave us one, I countered. He didn't insist that we join him.
What are our choices, then? Should we fumble about on a totally alien and very bizarre world? In hopes of doing what, exactly?
Finding food, for one thing, Sean put in.
The cupboard is bare.
We've been invited to lunch, John reminded him.
We could be walking into a trap, I said.
Can we be sure Prime will let us leave?
We've seen his power.
He may be able to do anything he wants with us.
That may very well be true, I said, nodding. But we don't know for sure.
He seems friendly enough, Susan said. Absolutely charming, in fact.
Zoya said,
I doubt very much that he is what he seems to be. I don't for a moment believe he is human.
And I don't believe he's God, Liam said.
I'm not what you'd call the religious sort, but guiding a boat in a shiny new roadster isn't my idea of how a supreme being should be conducting himself.
He scratched his effusive light brown beard.
Of course, I'm not so sure exactly how a supreme being should be conducting himself, but
I know what you mean, John said.
I think we should dispense with that notion straight off. Prime is obviously an advanced form of life. Perhaps he's even immortal.
But eternal? Hardly.
Okay, I said. We're in agreement on that score. I'd also add that, though he might be very powerful, he probably isn't omnipotent. Or omniscient, or all-loving and good, either. He says he has something to accomplish, but we don't know. But his plans seem to include us. We have to decide whether we want to cooperate. We might not like what he wants to do.
Darla said, maybe he'll give us the choice of not cooperating.
There's that possibility, I answered, turning in the driver's seat to face her. She was squatting behind the seat, forearm resting on the back. She looked as pretty as ever. Her hair had grown out quite a bit, softening the effect of the severe cut she'd worn when we first met. The hardships of our journey had left their mark. She looked tired most of the time, which could have been due to her pregnancy, though she was only a little shy of 3 months into it. She'd been gaining weight, too. Her features were slightly more fleshed out. A little, not much. Darla, I said, what's your gut feeling? Do you trust Prime? She pursed her lips and thought about it for a long time. Then, she said,
"We have no reason to trust him. Absolutely none. Ask me on a bad day and I'd say no. Let's not go near him."
She ran a hand through her hair. Tired or not, Darla always looked as if she'd just stepped out of a beauty parlor. Hair in place, makeup perfect.
"And though I wouldn't exactly call this a good day, I get this feeling that we simply must deal with him. We'll have to if we want to get back."
She sighed.
"Do I trust him? No farther than I could throw Sean. What's my gut feeling?"
She shrugged helplessly.
"Let's go to lunch."
"I don't know, Darla, my girl," Sean said with a grin. "After the way you handled those two beefy lagers back on Taltry, I wouldn't give odds on how far you could throw me."
Darla smiled, a little abashedly.
"Oh, no. You should be proud, Darla."
Sean's grin broadened, and he swelled with satisfaction.
"Ah, I'll never forget the sight of Tommy Baker, gorked out across the bed with his arse hanging out. He had it coming, and it was a fine thing to see him get it."
"I caught him at a delicate moment," Darla said.
"Anybody else want to express his or her opinion?" I asked around. "Susan?"
"Oh, I trust him. Darla's right, no good reason. But isn't everybody interested in finding out what this guy's all about? And where the heck are we, anyway? What is this place? Only Prime can tell us that."
"Lori, how about you?"
"Well,"
she gave Carl a sidelong, admonitory glare.
"If certain people can behave themselves, I say we go to the Emerald City.
I won't punch the guy again, but I'm not promising any more than that."
"You'll behave or I'll give you a fat lip."
"Don't worry, I'll be goody-two-shoes."
"Whoever that is."
I said,
"John?"
"Oh, yes, by all means. We should accept his invitation."
I looked at Yuri and Zoya.
"I agree with the consensus," Yuri said. "We certainly need some answers."
Zoya looked out the port moodily.
"It might serve us to be cautious. Perhaps we should make some attempt to communicate with him. Talk to him further. Find out exactly what he wants of us."
"Do you really think we can remain safe from him?"
Yuri asked skeptically.
"Simply by staying away from that fortress of his?"
"No, but..."
She focused her gaze far away.
"I don't think I want to go there."
"What's all the discussion?" Roland broke in impatiently. "You saw what he did to Carl. If he wants, we all drop over dead, like that. So what choice do we have?"
"Good point," John said. "I just wanted to take time and think things over," I said to Roland. "And I wanted everyone to have a say in what we should do."
"Sorry, Jake. I just don't see the point in haggling over this."
"Maybe there is none, but we've been running in a panic for a long time now. For once, I want the luxury of ruminating over our next move."
Roland laughed and sat back in the shotgun seat.
"Take all the time you want. We have most of eternity."
"Exactly," I said. "Ragna, would you and Oni like to put your two cents in?"
Not counting George and Winnie, who were what exopologists would label borderline sapient quasi-hominids, looked like apes to me, funny ones, with long floppy ears and big wet eyes, Ragna and Oni were the only alien members of our party. They had joined us in the rig during our rest up, abandoning their cramped vehicle, and had since taken pains to be as unobtrusive as possible, keeping to themselves and generally trying not to be an added burden, which they weren't. I liked them a lot. Ragna blinked, translucent nictitating membranes sliding up to cover the eyeballs before the lids came down. He put his hands up to adjust his blue headband, which was a linguistic translating interface.
"The reference to outmoded monetary units is understood denotatively, but not colloquially. However, I am getting the gist of your nub. Yes, we are having a contribution to be making, which is this.
He glanced at Oni, who nodded consent.
We, being the non-human minority of this band of intrepid explorers, note irony, are hardly in a position to be saying anything yea or nay, since, by the same token, we have not been invited along, but more or less have crashed this party, if you are following my rhetoric. Be that as it may, and by the life of me, it very well may, we say, yes, by gosh, let us by all means go to the fortress of this prime fellow and ask him to put his 2 cents into the bargain as well.
He smiled sheepishly.
If you get what I am meaning.
I get what you were meaning, I said. Who else? Sean? Liam?
I'm hungry, Sean said. Let's go and eat.
He's always hungry, Liam said.
But count me in too.
I'm bored, Roland said. Let's get moving.
Sam, I said.
Oh, I have a vote?
Sam, you always have at least a kilo credits worth to put in, Susan said. And you know it.
Thank you, ma'am. What I say is, I'd be wary of this prime dude.
I waited for more, then. That's it?
Yep. I guess you have change coming, Susie.
Oh, come on, Sam, I said. Spill it.
Nothing to spill. I'm a computer, remember? Give me data to analyze, numbers to crunch, I'll give you a readout. But don't ask me to make anything out of recent events. It's all too crazy for me. Emerald cities? Fairy castles? Crazy planets? Some guy who thinks he's God? Forget it. I'm shutting down. Wake me when it's over.
I'll come off it, I said. Every time you're put on the spot, you go into that I'm just a computer routine.
Seriously, I think this is a human judgment situation. It calls for acting on a hunch, an intuition, a feeling in your belly. Computers don't have bellies to get feelings in.
Sam, when are you going to admit to yourself that you're human?
Son, I was human for 72 years. That was enough.
But your Vlathusian entelechy matrix, John put in, makes your responses absolutely indistinguishable from those of a human mind fully possessed of every faculty. It's enough to fool anybody. Sometimes I half believe you're really a person hidden away in this lorry somewhere, speaking into a microphone and putting us all on.
Well, you've found me out, John. You're right. I'm a fraud. Thing is, I'm only 1 decimeter tall. You'll never find me.
You see, computers don't usually have a sense of humor. Jake's right. You are undeniably human, Sam, whether you like it or not.
Be that as it may, Sam said. Getting back to the issue at hand, though, I think you've made your decision already.
We haven't heard from everybody yet, Susan said.
Who dat? I asked.
You, Jake. What do you think?
I sat back and exhaled. Well, just on general principles, like Yuri said, we need some answers. I have a few questions to put to Mr. Prime myself. And if I don't like the answers, I might just take a poke at him too. But I have other reasons for wanting to visit Emerald City. Moore and his gang are out here somewhere. We might be safer inside the city.
Maybe Prime invited them to lunch too, Roland said.
When? Did I miss something? Or did they get here before us? I thought Moore and his crew took off in the other direction.
Maybe Prime contacted them by radio, or telepathy or something.
He didn't contact us that way.
True, Roland admitted. But he might still do that thing. Invite them.
Okay, I said. I'll buy that. But we'll have to inform Prime that under no circumstances will we remain under the same roof with those birds.
I'll drink to that, Sean said. Which reminds me, I've a god awful thirst.
Our beer reserves also had been under strict rationing. Susan said,
Do you really think they're still after us? I mean, what do we have that they want? The black cube?
I'd give them that, I said. Nobody seems to want the damn thing.
One good thing, Sam said. Old Corey Wilkes won't be giving us any trouble. He was behind it all, and now that he's gone, I think Moore might have a hard time thinking up reasons to give us grief.
Except that he has a score to settle with me, I said.
Well, maybe. You'd think he'd have had just about enough by now.
Not our Mr. Moore, Liam said. You don't know him, Sam.
I think I do, I said. And I'm worried. I looked out the side port. The sun was declining toward the horizon. It looked to be late afternoon, the sky having turned a slightly deeper shade of blue-violet. The green of the grass-carpeted hills was iridescent, a psychotic, delirious green. The neat shrubbery was variously colored, here pinks and reds, there browns and oranges. This place had the feel of a park, a playland. I turned and yelled,
"Winnie, where are you?"
"Probably getting it on with George," Roland said. "Those two are a pair."
Winnie came scurrying out of the aft cabin, threading her way through the thicket of human legs and bodies. George followed her.
"Winnie here, Jake."
"Come here, girl." She jumped up into my lap. I rubbed the bony, fur-covered knot between her floppy ears.
"What do you think, Winnie?" I said.
Winnie thought, knitting her low brow. She put a lot of effort into it. Then she asked,
"What think about?"
"Huh? Oh, about that man we met. The one with the pretty clothes. Did you like him?" She shrugged. I wondered if the gesture were learned or innate.
"Big man," Winnie said. "Big."
"Big? If anything, Prime had been on the short side. You mean important? Powerful?"
"Yes, that. Big man. Portent."
She groped for elaboration, then said simply,
"Real big man."
Then, an afterthought,
"Many."
"Many? You mean much? Much big?"
"Many,"
she said flatly.
"Many? More than one? He has friends?"
She considered it.
"No, he many. More than one."
"I see." I looked to the group for comment. None. Turning to George, who was no taller but a little more bulky about the midsection, I asked,
"What's your opinion, George, old bean?"
George gave me a puzzled look.
"Do you think Prime, that man, is big and many?"
He nodded.
"Many more than one."
He continued nodding emphatically for a moment, then stopped and pondered.
"But he won also, too."
"Eh? He's one? Just one man?"
"But many also. One, many."
"This is beginning to sound suspiciously theological again," John said. "One in many. Next, they'll be expounding on the doctrine of the Trinity." "How did they tumble to all this?" Liam asked incredulously.
"These two know everything," Susan said. "I've always had the feeling that Winnie has known everything all along."
"Can you explain, George?" I asked.
"Explain. Say more?" George scratched his belly and cogitated.
"Prime. He not man."
"Oh? He's not? What is he?"
"Splain."
He looked as if a headache were coming on.
"He..."
The belly scratching grew more vigorous. George screwed up his face in frustration.
"He... Prime, he..."
"Okay, okay. Don't get upset. It's all right that you can't say it."
"He all of them," George blurted. "All. One. Many.
He stopped scratching. Something dawned on him, a faint light at the horizon of his understanding. His gaze was drawn out the port to the sky.
Me,
he said. He stared for a moment, then lowered his eyes to Winnie.
Winnie, too. She also. We.
He pointed to her, then brought his stubby index finger back to rest on his chest.
Me. Us.
He tapped the finger.
We many.
That said, he sighed, looking a bit sad.
Explain no more.
There was a long silence. Presently, I said, Thanks, George. Winnie. Winnie gave me a hug and got down. Well, gang, I said, not particularly apropos of anything.
Yes. Well, John said.
What do you say we get moving?
Yeah,
Susan said emptily. I turned forward, put my foot on the accelerator pedal, and took hold of the control bars.
Start her up, Sam.
Sam did. The engine thrummed to life. I looked out across the valley at the green glass fairy palace, and finally thought of something to say. I suppose there was an impish grin on my face when I tried to come out with, Well, gang, we're...
If you say we're off to see the wizard, Sam declared, I'll come out of my hidey hole and bite you on the ass.
3. The trip across the valley floor was leisurely and uneventful. We passed other structures along the way, ones we hadn't really noticed with the green fortress riveting our attention. We took time to puzzle over them now. One looked like a cross between an ionic temple and a chemical factory. Another was in the shape of a squashed silver sphere melded to a blue pyramid. A third, lying some distance off the road, was a free-form aggregation of butterfly wing shapes. There were others, less easy to describe. Needless to say, we didn't have a clue as to what they were or what functions they served, if any. I suspected that some of them weren't buildings, exactly. Sculpture? Possibly. Machines? Maybe. The Emerald City was different. There was a fanciful quality to it. Its lines were graceful and romantic, belying its bulk. It imparted a sense of solidity, though. It was big enough to contain a city, and if it truly were a fortress, a castle, it looked the part. High ramparts braced against the wind. It looked to have been carved out of a single uniform block of material. No seams, no joints. It was a castle, but it was unlike anything you'd see in history books. An alien hand had drawn the blueprints. I was willing to bet on that. Sam asked,
What was that about an entrance at the foot of the mountain?
That's what the man said. But what was there was simply the end of the road. The Skyway, that maze of interstellar road that stretched throughout the galaxy, terminated at the base of the citadel in front of a stand of short, purplish trees. Road's end. We had come a long way. I braked.
Whoa! Sam yelled. What's this?
The juncture of road and hillside parted. The edge of the hill rising like a hiked skirt, scrubby trees stitched to the hem. It stopped just high enough to admit the truck, forming an arch that revealed the mouth of a tunnel. The road continued through.
What do you think of that, Sam? I asked. Nifty.
Shall we drive on in?
Sure. I'll put the headbeams on.
I looked at the underside of the tunnel mouth as we drove through the aperture. It was all metal inside. No earth or debris rained down on us, and I couldn't for the life of me figure out how this trick was being done, but I didn't have much time to study it. The tunnel was smooth-walled, lit by oval recessed fixtures positioned at regular intervals directly overhead. Otherwise, it was featureless and reminded me of the Roadbug Garage Planet, where the bugs had caught us, then dragged us across light years to this place. The tunnel bore through the mountain for about half a kilometer before it debouched into a dimly lit, expansive cavern. But here, the similarity to the Roadbug planet ended, though the place did look like a garage. The skeletal shapes of huge cranes and gantries loomed in the shadows. Strange machinery lay everywhere. There were scores of vehicles here, too, some parked out in the middle of the floor and appearing ready for use, others occupying numerous maintenance bays recessed into the walls. The vehicles were of every shape and description.
How much to park here by the hour? Sam wanted to know.
Where's the attendant? I asked.
But seriously, folks, how the hell do we get up to the city from here? Elevator, I guess, Carl said.
Yeah, I said. Where? This place is big. See anything?
We roamed through the place for a few minutes.
What's that? Roland said, pointing.
Where?
Looks like a ramp. See? Through that opening right there, against the far wall. No, now you can't see it. Behind that big electrical coil-looking thing. Oh.
I eased the rig forward and saw it. It was a sharply inclined ramp, barely wide enough to admit a small vehicle.
No go for the truck. Looks like some sort of way up, I said. But we'll have to hoof it.
Looks like I stay here, Sam said.
Sorry, Sam.
Well, I'd be a little obtrusive sitting at the table anyway. Enjoy your lunch.
I scrammed the engine.
Okay, here we go.
The cavern was cool, redolent of garage smells. Not oil and grease, just the definite ambience of heavy machinery.
Everybody have everything? I asked when all the crew had gotten out. We might not be back here for a while.
Got all my no-gon camping gear, Susan said while reaching behind to adjust a strap on her backpack. Don't know what use it'll be, but what the hell?
Good idea to bring anything we might possibly need, I said. There's no telling what's up there. Anybody else?
Everybody was content to make the trip up with what he had. I took out my key and spoke into it.
Okay, Sam. Take care, and keep an eye out for trouble.
You too. Good luck.
We made our way over the dark, smooth floor, toward the archway that led to the ramp, walking past some extremely bizarre vehicles. They were composed of various geometrical shapes shoved together at odd angles. Farther along, there were more vehicles, these more comprehensible but very alien in appearance. Liam was first through the archway. He looked up and stopped in his tracks.
Mother of God, he said quietly.
We joined him at the bottom of a huge cylindrical shaft that shot straight up through the mountain, its vanishing point lost in darkness. Running straight up the middle of the shaft without visible support was a vertical ramp, a wide ribbon of some metallic substance, its color a pale blue, its bottom end curling outward like a length of tape. It touched the floor at a perfect tangent to form the ramp we'd seen from the truck. We walked around it, keeping our distance. I walked around it twice, then again. The damn thing wasn't even 3 centimeters thick.
It's a laundry chute, Carl ventured. Yeah, for express laundry, I said.
Carl nodded.
Well, the way it really works is you're supposed to get this really good running start, see? Like this.
He backstepped, then ran up the sharply curling end of the ramp to a point where it became nearly vertical. He pivoted sharply and began to run back down.
But he didn't. Couldn't. His grin disappeared.
Hey!
He began to glide up the ramp. He was still facing down, his body perpendicular to the ramp and now horizontal to the ground, held fast by some mysterious, attractive force. He could move his feet, though. He tried walking back down, but the upward drift was too rapid. He started to run, clumsily, his steps slow and heavy.
Holy hell!
He yelled.
I can't...
We all stood, merely gawking. I couldn't think of a thing to do to help him. It was the strangest thing, watching him being borne straight up on this impossible vertical treadmill. As his ascent speed increased, he gave up running and turned slowly until he was facing up the shaft.
"Hey!" he called over his shoulder. "I guess this is the way up."
He laughed mirthlessly, the smooth walls of the shaft carrying his echoing voice down to us.
"Anyway, I sure as shit hope so."
"Carl!"
Lori screamed after him, her eyes round with fear and disbelief.
"Carl, be careful!"
"I think he's right, girl," Sean said. "That's the way up."
I stepped forward and tentatively put my right boot on the ramp, testing it. I felt no pull, no quasi-magnetic attraction. I inched my foot forward. Someone grasped my arm. Darla, stepping up onto the ramp with me.
"Going up?" she said, smiling.
"I'm with you, kid."
We climbed the steep incline. We hadn't taken more than a few steps when it began to happen. The world tilted. My sense of up and down rotated about 45 degrees. Suddenly, the ribbon of metal was no longer vertical, but merely steep, and we rode upward as if on an escalator in a department store. I could move my feet, but it was like walking in sticky mud. It was a little disorienting, but not unpleasantly so. I turned until I faced down the ramp. Everybody was just standing there.
"Hey," I called. "It's okay. Hop aboard."
They exchanged shrugs and reluctantly approached the ramp. I shuffled back around again. Carl, a good distance ahead, was waving and shouting something I couldn't hear. I waved back.
"Don't get too far ahead," I yelled.
He cupped his hand to his ear, so I yelled louder. He heard, nodded, and tried walking back down again. But he was still gaining speed. He finally gave up and threw out his arms in despair. We were accelerating too. I looked at my feet. It was hard to tell whether we were sliding over the surface or being carried along by some mysterious movement of the surface itself, as if it were a conveyor belt. The ramp was seamless, featureless, and the shaft around us was dark. I finally decided that we were sliding, and I was almost sure that the soles of my boots weren't actually touching the ramp, but riding a few millimeters above it. It was a quick trip up. A disk of light grew at the top of the tube, and we rushed toward it. Our speed was hard to judge, but we were moving right along, and the sensation was exhilarating. The experience recapitulated my recent recurring dreams, my fantasies, plunging headlong through a dark tunnel toward a source of brilliant light. I'd read something somewhere about that image, about it being a recapitulation of the birth experience. I considered it. I'm not one to set much store by armchair psychology, but there was an undeniable feel of truth to the notion. We suddenly decelerated. My sense of orientation did a double flip as the ramp leveled off, shot through an opening into a large green chamber, and became one with the floor. Darla and I slid to a gradual halt, took a few jogging steps, and walked off the end of the ramp onto polished black marble.
"Where's Carl?"
Darla asked. I looked around. We were in a large, circular room. Arched openings were cut into the walls at regular intervals. Ramp ends came out of them, converging and terminating on the circular black area where we stood.
"Darned if I know," I said.
4.
"Where's Carl?"
was the first thing John Sakuma Taylor asked as he stepped off the magic escalator.
"Good question," I said.
"He seems to have misplaced himself." John scowled and shook his head.
"That damn fool. If he gets us into more trouble..."
"I'm more worried that something might have happened to him."
The scowl dissolving, John nodded dourly.
"Oh, I suppose you're right. Any idea where he might have gone?"
"No. I didn't want to go looking until you'd all come up. How far behind you were the others?"
When I looked back, Susan seemed to be having the most trouble getting on the thing. I don't know what possessed me to go first after you two, but I did. I think... Oh,
Here they are. Out of the oval opening in the green wall came Lori, Yuri, Zoya, Ragna, and Oni. Following close behind was Sean, hand in hand with Winnie and George. There was a moderate delay before Liam and Roland came through, propping up between them a slightly gray-faced Susan. Susan stumbled off the strip, moaned, and put a hand to her stomach.
"Oh my God!"
"You okay, Susie?" I said. She heaved a sigh, then burped.
"Excuse me. Roller coasters always made me sick."
Roland laughed and slapped her on the back.
"Oh, come on, Susan. It wasn't that bad."
Susan winced and rolled her eyes.
"I don't believe we went straight up. Straight up. It was the worst. Ooh, I can't stand it."
She belched again.
"Carl is missing,"
Darla told Sean, who had been glancing around the chamber.
"We lost sight of him on the way up," I said. "And he wasn't here when we arrived. I suggest we start looking."
"T' boy's got the devil in him for sure," Sean said. "But he wouldn't run off like this. Something must have happened."
"Whatever happened," I said, "it was fast. We couldn't have been more than 30 seconds behind him."
"Do you think Prime had something to do with it?" Liam asked me.
"Could be."
"Odd thing," Sean said. "I thought Prime would be here to greet us."
"And I am. Welcome."
The voice filled the domed chamber.
"Hello?"
I said, whirling to find the source.
"Forgive me," Prime's voice said. "I am afraid that certain exigencies have prevented me from greeting you in person. I will be joining you shortly, however, and until then, I've provided..."
"Where's Carl?" I shouted.
"I'm sorry?"
A pause, then...
"Oh, yes. It seems the young man has gotten himself lost. That is a very easy thing to accomplish in this place, I'm afraid. Please don't worry. He also will join you very soon. He's quite safe, I assure you."
"We're concerned," I told him.
"Of course you are, and I don't blame you in the slightest. You are in a strange place, and have quite naturally assumed that there is potential danger here. I fully appreciate your prudent distrust of me. I could very well be an enemy. And I also realize you must have grave reservations concerning any assurances I might give to the contrary. After all, you know very little about me. Now, what I ultimately want you to understand is that your fears about me are not justified. I bear you no ill will and mean you no harm. As time goes on, this will become apparent. Having said this, however, I want to warn you that your natural caution about this place is justified. There is indeed potential danger here, both inside this structure and on this planet, though the perils outside these walls far outstrip those within. Let us deal with the proximate variety. There are in and about these rooms and towers numerous artifacts which, if used improperly, may be a source of trouble. Also, the dangers of getting lost here are quite real. This structure has certain, shall we say, architectural peculiarities, which, until they are understood and taken into account, can cause accidents. In short, you would be wise to use discretion and be generally circumspect in your movements until you get used to your surroundings. I hope I have made myself clear."
"I said, you mentioned something about dangers outside?"
"Of those, you will learn more later. They would be difficult to describe without my giving you an extensive briefing on the situation here."
"Okay, but I take it you aren't alone on this planet. There are others, correct?"
"You might say that."
I was suddenly annoyed. This guy had a knack for answering questions with an unambiguous maybe.
"Thanks for the info," I said. "You said something about lunch? Also, something about straight answers to our questions?"
There was an indulgent smile implied in the voice.
I understand your impatience, but perhaps you need time to think about your questions first.
A chuckle, then.
You are very intelligent and resourceful creatures, of that I have no doubt. Intelligent enough, perhaps, to realize that what you face here is entirely strange and new to your experience. You will be exposed to ideas and concepts which may be difficult for you to grasp. Ultimately, the goal of complete understanding might lie beyond your capabilities. I very much doubt it, but that is one proposition which must be put to the test. In any case, the learning experience itself should prove rewarding. This is why I contend that you need time. Impatience is counterproductive at best. And here on this world construct, which I propose we call microcosmos, for want of a better name, it could conceivably prove lethal.
I nodded. Okay, fine. I'm sure I speak for all of us when I say we're eager to learn. And you can bet we'll be careful. But frankly, the suspense is already killing me. And I'm hungry.
Prime gave a gentle laugh. No doubt. Just a moment.
We waited, maybe a quarter minute. Then, out of an archway to our right, came a glowing green sphere floating about 2 meters off the floor.
What you see is rather hard to explain technically, Prime told us, but its function is simple. It will guide you to the dining hall, where, if you are still amenable, we will have lunch. Please follow it there. I will join you shortly.
I hate to keep pestering, I said. But what about Carl? No reply.
What about Carl? Laurie shouted. Answer us!
The green sphere bobbed, then receded through the archway and into a dark corridor running tangentially to the circular chamber. There, it paused, as if waiting for us.
Lead on, Macduff, John called to it as he started forward.
He halted and looked around at everybody.
Well?
Susan was still nursing her middle.
I can't think of food right now, but maybe if I forced something down...
Right, Roland said. Then I'll take you for a ride on the magic ramp again. We'll look for the one that goes down this time.
Oh, please.
We followed the green sphere. Prime hadn't been kidding about the architectural oddity of the place. Everything was goofy. Walls curved and canted vertiginously. Floors sloped at odd angles. Weird perspectives tricked us at every turn. Even so, the place had a bizarre beauty to it. Rather stark, though. The walls were smooth and unadorned. No pictures, carvings, or decorations. No tapestries, weapons, or shields emblazoned with colorful heraldry. Not a proper castle after all. The floor everywhere black, with a deep shine, looking like a dark mirror. Here and about, though, stood odd thingamabobs, no doubt the artifacts Prime had warned us about. Some looked like pieces of machinery. Others could have been sculpture, or, for all we knew, alien hat racks.
This place is a damn museum, Susan said.
I was just about to say that, John told her.
I said, does have the feel of one. An odd one, though. There didn't seem to be much organization to it. Some things were lying about haphazardly. They weren't necessarily on display. Nevertheless, I got the distinct impression that this was a collection, a bunch of stuff that had been obtained at various places and carted here for storage. We soon came to a high-ceilinged hall featuring a large, centrally positioned table of irregular shape. Uniformly constructed seating appliances, the term chairs would tend to connote that one could easily sit in them, were arranged around the table. But what was on the table wasn't strange. It was food, and it all looked good. There was a huge, whole baked ham, assorted roast fowl, fish, various cuts of beef, one or two of pork, and maybe one of veal. These entrees were flanked by vegetable dishes, casseroles, fruit arrangements, baskets of bread, tureens of soup, bowls of salad, and on and on. There was other stuff I couldn't readily identify, but it looked very familiar. All in all, this was something more than lunch, and slightly less than a state dinner for a visiting foreign dignitary. The eating utensils looked alien but serviceable, as did the glassware. We looked it over. Meanwhile, our shining guide drifted away, exiting through an arch and into darkness.
"Quite a spread," Susan commented.
"How are your insides?" I asked.
"Getting better."
We all stood about gawking until Prime entered the hall through an archway to the left. Smiling, he strode to the approximate head of the table and stood.
"Welcome. I'm glad you came. Please, be seated."
We chose places around the table. Along with the rest of the gang, I regarded the chair on which I was to seat myself. It was pink, shiny, and looked somewhat like a formation of coral. The prospect of actually using the thing as a seat involved the possibility of having an autoerotic experience, or a painful one, depending on how careful you were.
"I think you will find,"
Prime began, but a shout from Laurie interrupted him. She had tried sitting, but had immediately sprung to her feet.
"It moved," she told us.
Prime chuckled.
"The chairs will automatically reform themselves to accommodate your bodies. Simply sit down and..."
Gingerly, I sat. The damn chair did that very thing, and it did it almost before my buttocks had touched down.
"There, you see?"
"Interesting," I said, as the chair made some further adjustments, these very subtle and done much more slowly. I sank into the thing a little, and it stopped. It was strange, but I was comfortable. When everyone had settled in, Prime poured himself a glass of amber liquid from a carafe.
"I think you'll find this wine very insouciant and a bit immature, but compatible with almost everything here."
He indicated a similar decanter near John, seated to his right. There were several around the table.
"Please serve yourselves. I must apologize for the lack of servants. The only one I have is engaged at the moment."
I picked up a carafe and poured the glass to my right for Susan, the left for Darla, and one for me. Prime raised his glass.
"I propose a toast. To life."
"Hear, hear," Sean said.
I inhaled the bouquet. While I was at it, I smelled the wine, too. What I got was the sense of a late summer day, ripe fruit fallen in the orchard, warm breath of flowers. Bright sun declining over the garden gate, the arbor heavy with grapes, fresh-cut hay fields, dreaming the afternoon away. Like that. Odors familiar, yet exotic somehow. More than odors. An ambiance. An experience. I drank the wine and drank in the experience. There was a taste, too. It was fruit and flowers and dew-laden sprigs of wild mint. It was a dash of crushed cinnamon, a twist of lemon, a drop of honey. It was many things. Presently, Darla said,
"I've never, ever tasted anything like this."
"I'm so glad you like it," Prime said, beaming. "It is very good, isn't it?"
"Ambrosia,"
John murmured, staring into his glass.
"What is it called? Does it have a name?"
Zoya wanted to know. Prime squinted one eye.
"I think, well, a free translation would be Earth's Sweet Breath of Summer."
"How appropriate. How lovely."
"Where does it come from?" Yuri asked.
"The beings who produced this wine were very much like yourselves, and were excellent winemakers. Possibly the best the universe ever saw. As I said, they were very much like you. In fact, They were your descendants, over 2 million years removed from your time.
2 million? Susan gasped.
Yes, they were still human, very human, and they still remembered Earth, apparently. No doubt they visited that most ancient home of humankind.
Where's Carl?
Lori broke in loudly. Prime looked at her, his expression tolerant.
He'll be here at any moment. You shouldn't worry so much, my dear.
2 million years in our future, John said. Very difficult to believe. But you speak as if that time were long past. To you?
Yes, it is, Prime said. It was quite long ago. But time, to us, to me, means very little.
Who's us? I asked.
Prime drank, sat back.
I have been thinking of the appropriate word or phrase to use. Something handy, short, concise, which would impart the meaning without too much distortion. In your language, there are a number of words, but I have chosen culmination. That is what we are. What I am. You may refer to us as the culmination.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.